Huge. Good morning, everyone. It's my privilege to welcome you back to the Peterson Institute for International Economics. I'm Adam Posen, the Institute's president, and we thank all of you who are joining us in person for this capacity crowd, and we hope over online around the world and throughout the U.S., and particularly on Capitol Hill, on Webstream, and on the videos and transcripts that will follow. The Peterson Institute is, of course, a nonpartisan institute. We're called a free trade institute sometimes, but what we really are is an economic analysis institute. And just as economic analysis tends to lead you, in most cases, to argue for free trade, economic analysis forces you to think hard about major tax reform. I'm delighted to see so many people in such interest in this topic. Several weeks ago, I called on my colleagues, many of whom are on the program today, but others of whom contributed behind the scenes, to address the idea of major corporate tax reform in the U.S., and in particular, the border tax adjustment, or what now is being called the destination-based cash flow tax, the DIBKUFT. I asked my colleagues to do this because, number one, it's important. I asked my colleagues to do this, number two, because it's something I think the Peterson Institute team was uniquely prepared to do, having the combination of macroeconomics, international trade, tax, this nexus that's so important for understanding this issue. But the third reason I asked is because facts and analysis matter. And I view the number of people here today from all areas, from business, from government, from academia, from labor, from around the world, from the U.S., as representing the fact that facts matter, that analysis, which at least tries to be objective and certainly is rigorous and transparent, matters. And then when we're making big choices for the future of the American economy, we should do the analysis. And that's what we've tried to do today. I'm very grateful in particular to my colleague Chad Bown, who coordinated our efforts on this. Many of you have seen the publications, short publications by Chad, by Carolyn Freund, by, of course, Gary Hufbauer, many others. We don't have, as we ever do, one unified position. We have a unified approach and a unified commitment to intellectual honesty. But I think there do emerge key themes that are going to become apparent over the course of today. They have to do with thinking through what it means to change corporate taxes in a global economy, even for the United States. And the starting point has to be that emphasis on the global economy, because one cannot wish away the existence of competitors around the world. One cannot wish away the legitimate aspirations of people in poor and rich countries alike to make a living themselves. And one cannot wish away the important benefits the U.S. has, nor should one wish away the important benefits U.S. has, including the U.S. corporate sector, from its integration with the world economy. And so we can talk about scaling it back in a variety of ways, and no doubt the Peterson Institute and all of you will be grappling with these efforts through the years to come. But starting with domestic taxes, as the proposal shows, you cannot ignore the world except at the American people's peril. And so we're going to try to bring that together today. The program is great. We have two panels, first on the global, thinking big picture about corporate tax reform. They'll get a proper introduction, but I want to particularly thank two participants there, Douglas Holtz-Eakin, former director of the CBO, now at American Action Forum. Doug, as many of you know, is not only a distinguished public finance economist, but has been at the center of the public discussions of this very issue, including with his co-authored papers with Alan Auerbach, and we're delighted he's joined us today. Also, our estimable colleague, Gary Hufbauer. Now, again, you all have heard me praise all my colleagues, but particularly Gary, many times. But on this issue, Gary deserves some parental rights over the push for a destination-based tax system in this country. And so when Gary takes an assessment of this version, I urge you all to listen carefully. I also want to thank, and I will make a bigger deal about this in short order, that the Honorable Jason Furman, our newest senior fellow, will be giving the keynote at lunch today, again, linking this to the bigger picture of tax reform in the United States. We are honored, pleased, and very happy to have Jason now as a senior fellow at the Peterson Institute, and we're delighted he's making his debut on our stage as a fellow on this most important issue. Thank you again for your attention. Thank you for paying attention to the analysis. Please tell the people in Congress, the staff, the leadership, the members, it matters what you do. It's not enough to just say, I want tax reform. I have to believe that the people in Congress care about that, and we're going to try to make it clear to them what's involved. Thank you.
Thank you, Adam. What I'm going to do is moderate the first panel this morning. So let me just take a moment to introduce again our first three speakers. And so first, I also would like to thank Doug Holtz-Eakin for coming today and kicking us off. As everybody knows, Doug is now the president of the American Action Forum and a world-renowned expert on tax policy. He has served in a number of important and very influential positions in the U.S. government, including as the chief economist of the Council of Economic Advisors, as the director of the nonpartisan Congressional Budget Office, the CBO. Prior to his work in public service and at the American Action Forum, he had a very distinguished academic career at Columbia University and Syracuse University. So he'll be kicking us off today. Following Doug will be my colleague, Gary Hufbauer, who's the Reginald Jones Senior Fellow here at the Peterson Institute, where he has had a long career researching and writing about almost every salient aspect of international trade, investment, and tax policy. This is important to note. Not only is Dr. Hufbauer a PhD economist, but he is also a legal scholar. And that's going to be important later on. I'm going to be talking a little bit about, in a later session, some WTO consistency aspects of this. And any hard questions that I get, I'm going to pawn off on Gary. But also, as Adam mentioned, he is not only one of the sort of the intellectual founders of this, but he also has important public service, having served at the Treasury as Deputy Assistant Secretary for International Trade and Investment Policy, and as director of the International Tax Staff. He played important roles for the United States in drafting the Tokyo Round codes on subsidies and having worked through some of the initial tensions on tax issues between the United States and the European Community at the time over things like DISC, FISC, et cetera. So Gary has multiple perspectives to bring to the debate that he'll hopefully share with us today. And then finally, Adam also needs no introduction, but let me provide a quick one anyway. Adam is the president of the Peterson Institute, having taken on that role in 2013. He's been affiliated with the Institute since 1997. His most recent public service is obviously beginning in September 2009, where he served a three-year term as an external voting member of the Bank of England's Rate-Setting Monetary Policy Committee. He's written extensively about almost all areas of macroeconomic policy that one could imagine across a range of different economies. And also, in addition to his leadership at the Institute, Adam currently advises the Congressional Budget Offices. So I'm going to turn it over to Doug next, but before I do, I thought I would lead off with a joke, which will probably be repeated many, many times today, which is, of all of the things that President Trump has said over the last couple of weeks, probably the most spot on was when he said in his interview with the Wall Street Journal that border tax adjustment is complicated. We're going to walk through a number of aspects of that today to try to cut through some of these complications. But I think he has it right. It is hard. It's going to deserve an honest and amiable public debate and discussion, and as Adam pointed out, analysis. And with that, we're happy to get started. So, Doug.
Well, thank you, Chad. Thank you, Adam. Thank you for the chance to be here today. Let me amend the introduction and remind folks here, they might not even know, I was briefly actually a Peterson Institute fellow. I've lost most of the good jobs in D.C., and that includes this place. So it's nice to be back in this hall. We're going to have a long and detailed discussion about the exact value of the nominal exchange rate for a couple hours now. So before we do that, why don't I step back and just remind everyone why it is we're having this discussion at all. And I think the starting point is the projected growth path of the U.S. economy. And for real people out there, between the end of World War II and 2007, the U.S. economy grew rapidly enough that even with the baby boom and an expanding population, GDP per capita, a crude index of the standard of living, doubled roughly every 35 years. And that meant that the average American during one working career could pursue their version of the American dream. And they could buy a house or a boat or whatever it was that they longed to do that their predecessors hadn't been able to do. Given the projected rates of GDP growth, near basically in the range of 2% in population growth, GDP per capita is going to double roughly every 70 years. And so there's a growing awareness that what used to be possible in for a person who worked hard their entire life will no longer be possible. And the need to engender better economic growth is at the core, I think, of most of the major policy issues facing the United States right now. And certainly it's at the core of the debate over tax reform, corporate, and more broadly. And in that context, it's important to remember that the U.S. corporation income tax is desperately in need of reform, and I would encourage no one to defend the status quo. The U.S. corporation income tax has all sorts of flaws. It is, number one, the most anti-growth tax that you can document in the research literature. I'm widely recognized as a crazy right-winger, but the OECD is not. And it has identified corporation income taxes as the single most anti-growth tax. And the U.S. Corporation income tax has the unique combination of the highest statutory rate among our developed competitors, and it has the unique feature of clinging to a worldwide system of taxation when virtually everyone else has moved to more territorial-like systems. That's a very bad combination. It hurts our capacity to grow. It hurts our ability to compete internationally. And the fact that we have a worldwide system means that when a U.S. firm is competing in Brazil with a German firm, the German firm is paying the Brazilian tax and is done. The U.S. firm is paying the Brazilian tax and then faces a second layer of tax up to the 35% rate when it brings the earnings back. And the result of that is either A, an immediate competitive disadvantage, or B, a corporation desperately trying to alleviate that disadvantage by not bringing the money back. And we have now an enormous amount of foreign earnings of U.S. headquartered firms that are not being brought back to the U.S. economy. And that combination of anti-growth and anti-competitiveness, I think, is at the core of the desire to have a radical reform of the U.S. corporation income tax. Underneath that, the system's incredibly complicated to comply with. It is incredibly complicated to administer. It's a very difficult system. And so we have something that's anti-growth, it's anti-competitive, it's very difficult to comply and administer, and it raises almost no revenue, about $300 billion a year in a budget that's going to be about $4 trillion very soon. So it flunks almost any test of what would be a sensible way to fund the U.S. government. And that, I think, is the starting point for the discussion, which is how can we do something to improve the taxation of businesses in the United States and allow for better economic performance. Into that setting comes two things. First, Dave Camp, as chairman of the Ways and Means Committee, making what I thought was a fantastic effort to put forth a comprehensive reform of the U.S. income tax system, individual plus corporate, tried very hard to make that reform revenue neutral, distributionally neutral, and did not, in fact, get that reform out of even his own committee. And I think the lesson learned from that, from the folks looking at tax reform in the United States, is that doing something within the constraints of the current income tax system was simply not going to get over the finish line, and that a new approach would be necessary, and something that, which was dramatically different than revisiting things like lowering the rate, broadening the base within the context of the current U.S. income tax system was probably not going to be successful. And I think that's the right way to think about what we're seeing in the House blueprint for tax reform that was released last summer and has been at the center of all the discussion so far. And I think that is an important step in tax reform in the United States. It moves us to something which is very close to a consumed income tax system. If you look at it, it is essentially a business tax that exempts from tax the normal rate of return on capital and taxes only economic profits. On the individual side, it has a 50% exemption of the return to capital. If it was 100%, you'd have essentially a consumed income tax, something which has been identified in the research literature as the single most pro-growth tax reform that one could get. There are some downsides on the transitions, but you'd have to look at that as the benchmark of where you'd want to go. So it's a very, very bold proposal. Not discussed very much so far has been the fact that on the individual side, the decision was made to, yes, lower marginal rates on the individual side, but to decouple the tax rate on business income from the individual marginal rates. So for pass-through entities, the tax rate is going to be 25% in this proposal. That's something that's not been done before. I think it's a very important part of the plan and something that has been little discussed. There's an increasing fraction of business income in the United States that is taxed as pass-through income. That pass-through income is now going to face a lower rate. It'll have the same base as the corporate side. On the corporate side, everyone in this room is probably now well aware, this is a cash flow tax. It is revenues in, expenses out, tax on the difference. It means that all tangible and intangible capital will be taxed, will be expensed in the first year of acquisition. It means that net interest costs will not be deductible. And from an economic perspective, that equalizes the treatment of debt and equity financed capital investment. You'll get more efficient allocation of capital. It is pro-growth tax reform as one could imagine. It will have provisions for research and development expenditures and thus augmenting the return to investing in innovation. And I think regardless of the specifics, that's the kind of tax reform that's going to be necessary for the U.S. to support the desire to have better rates of economic growth. Now let me take some time to talk a little bit about the border adjustment, which has been at the center of such discussion and I think has been in many cases poorly understood by a lot of the folks discussing what's going on. The idea is to take this cash flow tax. This is a territorial tax system, moves away from the worldwide system to tax only the tax base in the United States, and it will be adjusted at the border. Border adjustment is a piece of tax policy. It is not trade policy. Am I allowed to say that at the Peterson Institute? Or is everything trade policy here?
You can say whatever you want.
You're my man, Adam. Wait. And I say that deliberately, and I want to say it as forcefully as possible, because that discussion has been conflated by some people deliberately, by some people out of ignorance, but border adjustment is not a trade policy. It is a tax policy. The goal, as is most good tax policy, is to achieve a neutrality result. Competition in the United States will be neutral between imported goods and domestic goods. Both will be subject to the same tax, the 20% corporation tax in the U.S. By exempting the tax on exports, competition in foreign countries will be determined by the taxes in those countries. It will be a level playing field between U.S. exports and the goods produced in Germany, Brazil, wherever. That kind of neutrality is the kind of thing a tax policy expert would aim for, and that's the goal of this. Despite its name, it will not be implemented at the border. It raises this sort of image of, you know, people standing at the border with either an ATM for the exporters and a collection belt for the importers. That's not the way it works. It will be implemented once a year when firms file their taxes. And they will, in calculating their tax base, they will take any cross-border transaction and simply discard it. So if you have revenue from exporting into Germany, you'll discard that revenue from calculating your tax base and thus exempt the exports from tax. If you have costs from importing from Korea, you will discard that transaction and thus not deduct it and impose the tax on imports. And so it will occur once a year at the end of the year. Its main virtue in the context of the House blueprint is to protect the integrity of the U.S. tax base. Because you are discarding all cross-border transactions in calculating your tax base, the valuation of those transactions does not matter for your tax liability. So your choice of transfer prices does not matter for your tax liability, and it removes all the incentives in a territorial system to transfer price your profits to a low-tax jurisdiction and return them to the U.S. tax-free. That goes away in this system, and that is a key part of what should be the discussion about border adjustment, because the choice is not between the House blueprint or the House blueprint without border adjustment. The choice is between the House blueprint, which has border adjustment in it, or the House blueprint without border adjustment and some other means of preventing base erosion, whether it's David Camp's option C or some other set of rules which go transaction by transaction and identify those which are genuine business transactions and those which are abusive avoidance of tax liability in the United States. The border adjustment has divided the business community, but the choice is not between a border adjustment that divides the business community. It's between border adjustment that divides it and base erosion rules, which will also divide it. And that's the real choice that is being faced in the U.S. right now. Excuse me. Past that, it's not trade policy because in the simplest framework, it's trade neutral, right? We're going to have a long discussion about this, but I'm going to make the case that there is every reason to expect that by exempting the exports, imposing it on the imports, the nominal exchange rate should adjust to offset the tax advantage of exporters and the tax disadvantage of importers and leave the cost basis of importers essentially unchanged, leave their profit margins essentially unchanged, and leave their need to change retail prices essentially zero. And that is a neutrality result. We'll have the same net trade that we had prior to the imposition of the border adjustment. We'll never see that. And the evidence that's been brought to bear on this question thus far is not actually about border adjustment. The reform as a whole will have, hopefully, big impacts on the U.S. economy. This is the most dramatic proposal to change business taxation ever in the United States. It is intended to dramatically change the growth trajectory of the economy as much as the designers could make it. In doing so, it will affect the fundamentals like the real exchange rate and the current account, and one should expect that. All of the things that the House does will have that impact. Those will take time. Those real changes will occur slowly and be phased in. The border adjustment per se, however, is a one-time, other things equal, nominal adjustment that's easy to price by markets and will happen fast. And so, unfortunately, in sort of fighting about the sort of facts on this case, no country has ever done us the favor of, for example, you know, imposing a VAT and then waiting a year and border adjusting it so we can see the border adjustment in isolation. And we're not going to see it if we do this in the United States either. So it's going to be very difficult to sort of tease out the evidence on this. But I think it actually is very important to recognize that there are two kinds of impacts: the basic reform and then the border adjustment per se. And that's what's going to go on out there. Let me close by saying sort of how this fits in the whole idea of tax reform in the United States. This has clearly gotten a lot of people's attention. It's had a life that I certainly never anticipated, and a debate that is far fiercer than I had thought it would be. But tax reform is a process, and even those who don't like the particulars of border adjustment or interest non-deductible interest or separating the pass-through rate from the top marginal rate, there are a lot of things in this that are controversial. If it is the case that this proposal is stopped right now, tax reform in the United States is not going to happen for years. And so from the point of view of getting to a better tax code, having something that supports better economic growth, having something that supports the international competitiveness of our firms, and thus the workers in those firms typically who have higher wages, better benefits than other jobs in the U.S. economy, I think it's important as a process matter to understand this and fix it, but to not stop it, because if we stop now, there will not be tax reform, and we'll be saddled with, again, a corporation income tax that doesn't help growth, hurts competitiveness, is incredibly complex, and raises almost no revenue. And that, I think, is the status quo that we simply should not continue to support. Thank you.
Thanks very much. I want to start by especially thanking my colleague, Zihao Liu, who worked with me on this, both on the PowerPoint and the policy brief, which is outside, and on many other projects. She's done tremendous work. And I also want to thank Adam for being very tolerant of different views on this contentious issue. So, there are a lot of pros and cons, as has been said, and I'm with the closer to the Holtz-Eakin camp on this than some of the others, but not quite on board. Here's a very quick snapshot of the blueprint, and it's essentially the cash flow tax is essentially a capital income tax with no deduction for net interest, but 100% deduction for capital outlays, and then a range of rates on payments from corporations to households, a cap on the pass-through entities tax at 25%. I want to pause for a moment on this. Doug mentioned it, but it's really important. The U.S. tax system differs from the business tax system differs from that of other countries in that the pass-through component of business activity is more than half of business activity in this country now. Pass-throughs are not taxed at the business level, they're taxed at the household level. And for that reason, when you do statistics on revenue from corporations as a percent of GDP, you get a low percentage for the U.S. because half of business activity is not taxed in the subchapter C corporate form. Those are misleading statistics. Pass-throughs are politically very important because of their great numbers and have a big influence, and Senator Hatch is particularly protective of them. It adopts the territorial system. As Doug said, there are a lot of flavors of territoriality, but the basic idea is to have the active income of subsidiaries of a multinational corporation not taxed in the home country. And that is now the worldwide standard. I've actually been advocating that for 25 years. I'm quite happy that it's come across most of the world. It's now perhaps coming to the United States. And for the reason that Doug said, it taxes subsidiaries wherever they operate the same, no matter whether the headquarters are Toronto or London or New York. And that has a lot of favorable benefits in terms of transfer pricing, inversions, and competitiveness. And it repeals the alternative minimum tax. Well, most controversial, of course, is the adjustment at the border, which is the focus of today's conversation. But international tax rates matter a lot, and I should have added a second bullet. Territoriality matters a lot, and I'm going to focus on those two. So coming to the corporate tax rates, there are a lot of data on this, and you'll see other charts during the course of the day. But that's the statutory range for major countries. Doesn't have China. It probably should have China in there. The U.S. statutory rate is now the highest for corporations since Japan has come down a bit. the marginal effective corporate tax rate, this is calculated by Jack Mintz and his colleagues at the University of Calgary. They've been doing it for a number of years. I think they've got the methodology down. The U.S. is not the highest, but it's high. Lucy Zihao Liu and I, and she did the heavy lifting on this, have calculated the average actual corporate tax rate paid by large firms. That's what counts in the international economy. Large firms, as Carolyn Freund's work has shown, and others, that really it's large firms which account for nearly all direct investment, a very large proportion of trade, both imports and exports and so forth. They're the ones that compete. And we took an average over a long period of time, 15 years. There's a tremendous variation year to year and tremendous variation between countries. As you can see, the U.S. is relatively high. It's not out of line on these numbers. But the reason to be concerned about this comparison is that that's a long period of time. It's about 16, 17 years. What has happened during this period is that other countries have come down on their statutory and marginal effective rates, as you would see in our policy brief, whereas the U.S. is stuck at these very high levels. So if we did this same analysis at 5 years from now, just looking at period between, let's say, 2016 and 2020, I think the U.S. would be the high-rate country in this period, and I was quite impressed by Prime Minister May's promise to reduce the British rate to 17%. So, to me, the most important reform is to get the rate down, and the second most important is to get territoriality into the system, into our system. It's everybody else has it. So now the case for border tax adjustments, as Doug voiced it, is it's the linchpin for the first major business tax reform since 1986. These major reforms don't happen often, maybe once in a generation. We had the 54 Act, big reform of the Internal Revenue Code. We had the 86 Act, and now 30 years later, we're talking about this. The reason it's a linchpin is there are three reasons. One, it provides a lot of revenue so long as the U.S. has a trade deficit, very important qualification, about a little over $1 trillion over 10 years, according to the scoring. Second reason, it reduces the incentives, especially for transfer pricing abuse and outsourcing, which is tax motivated, that is producing abroad because the taxes are lower there and then shipping back to the U.S. I think that's a very, very small portion of actual foreign direct investment abroad. Politically, it seems to dominate the conversation, at least of the current administration. And transfer pricing, because the once you have a border tax, you don't have the incentives, same incentives for transfer pricing, and you don't have the same extent of incentives for inversions. If you get the rate down and you have the border adjustment, you don't eliminate the incentive for inversion, but you reduce it very considerably. And then without border tax adjustments, again, as a political matter, it would be very hard to introduce territoriality, because the argument would be, okay, you've got this very low cash flow tax, but it's not zero, which corporate taxes are zero in some places, very small countries, and they're much lower in other countries, such as Ireland, at 12.5%. So if you don't have the border tax adjustment, companies will just locate in these very low tax countries, and you have territoriality, so the combination of no border tax adjustment and territoriality, companies will just build all their plants overseas and ship the goods back to the United States. I think that's a complete myth economically, but it's very, very powerful politically, and this is clearly a political debate. Many countries have introduced territorial systems, and they don't have this imagined problem. In fact, nearly all countries have introduced it, starting right to the north with Canada and Britain and France and on and on. But it's a very big political concern in the United States. But as everyone here knows, the opposition is quite strong in certain industries which have a very high ratio of imports to exports, and I've named some of those. Now, for my taste, if we could get territoriality and lower rates without border tax adjustments, I'd be just delighted. So I see the border tax adjustments as the price of getting these other virtues of a dramatically reformed corporate tax system. And somebody will come up with an alternative. Doug said, Camp wrestled with this and didn't have too much success a couple of years ago. So the White House thrives in chaos, and I won't walk through these statements because I think everybody probably remembers them, but the confusion on the White House approach to border tax adjustments is quite severe, but it seems to be shifting from being against to possibly being for, and how the White House comes out, I think, will be decisive. If the White House comes out against border tax adjustments, I think the chances are very, very low. If it comes out for them, it improves the chances very considerably. So the big issues are compatibility with WTO rules, the extent of the exchange rate offset, and the tax incidence. So those are the three big, and I'm not going to provide definitive answers to any of the three, but I will just survey the terrain. So on the WTO perspective, as was said, it's complicated. That isn't what Trump was referring to, but it is truly complicated. The first point I would make, and others in the program today will disagree, is that many countries might be persuaded not to bring a case. And there is precedent for this. The Helms-Burton Law was about to be challenged by the European Union. It was not challenged for the reason that at the time, the Clinton administration, basically told the Europeans, if you challenge this and you prevail, that will blow up the WTO. There are many cases that are not brought in the WTO which could arguably be brought because they're kind of too big for the system. Another one which both the George W. Bush and the Obama administration did not bring was on currency. There's a whole big draft brief was written arguing that currency undervaluation or manipulation is inconsistent with Article 15 of the GATT. But for various reasons, it was not brought. And one reason was that if it was brought and if the argument prevailed that currency undervaluation or manipulation somehow defined was a breach of the WTO, you know, would the system endure? I mean, that would be a big transfer of power from the monetary folk and the centered in the IMF and finance ministries to the trade folk centered in the WTO. So case wasn't brought. I think this is a comparably big case. So I think many countries would not bring it. I think some would bring it. The second point on procedure is that cases take a long time. For cases which resulted in countermeasures, the average, according to what Zhihao calculated, is 7 years. But at least it'd be 4 years for a panel. And say the WTO dispute settlement mechanism is completely overloaded. Can't even take new cases now for quite a period of time. But then you have to get a panel and have to get agreement on that. Very tedious. Then you get a an appellate body decision, and then you have a arbitration panel afterwards, which is usually the original panelists, and that's a very long process. So a case might not be determined while the Trump administration is in office. And then an adverse decision, if it came, might well be followed by a renegotiation of the rules rather than the kind of massive retaliation, which there'll be some illustration of that later in the program today. But of course, countries might not wait for the WTO to adjudicate the border tax issue. They might instead apply countervailing duties against U.S. exports, their imports. There is the matter of the specificity test. If one actually reads the agreement on subsidies and countervailing measures, it's not at all clear that this kind of border tax adjustment on the export side is specific, but there could be cases in any event. And then if a case was brought against the U.S. would be in the position of going to the WTO, and again, there'd be a fairly long period of time before any decision was issued by the WTO against or for the countervailing duty. Now, in the WTO, to be a little more into the weeds on this, there are quite distinct rules depending on whether you're talking about imports of goods, exports of goods, imports of services, or exports of services. And this is a very brief summary, and there's more detail in our policy brief. On the imported goods, the national treatment requirement speaks to products. And this this word is kind of a magnet for a lot of lawyers like Joel Trachman, very distinguished lawyer. He doesn't see a product test unless there's a piece of paper that identifies the tax on, you know, this microphone or that table or whatever. I don't think most economists would take that view, and some colleagues of Jason Furman, a colleague of Jason Furman, went right through this and analyzed it as a product tax. I think the core essence of a product tax is whether it's reasonably uniform within the country, and so therefore you can assume that firms will all have their supply curves lifted up and the price will be passed on to purchasers of the good. And, very importantly, whether it's adjusted at the border. If it's not adjusted at the border, for example, a value-added tax, if it were not adjusted at the border, it would be hard to envisage it as a product tax because competitors from outside would have lower prices in a world of fixed exchange rates as exists within the European Union, which has all countries have value-added taxes, but they're at very, very different rates. So it's the adjustment at the border, whether it exists or not, and the uniformity of the tax, which I think determines largely whether it's a product tax or not. But that will be a big dispute, or would be a big dispute. Secondly, on exported goods, it's not the same test. It's whether it's a direct or an indirect tax. Now, this test, I think, it has a long ancestry. I think it's totally inappropriate today. The reason we have this distinction between direct taxes and indirect taxes is that when the distinction was formulated in people's minds, the direct taxes were on whiskey and tobacco, and the indirect taxes were on whiskey and tobacco, and the direct taxes were on property. That very simple world of two types of taxes. Well, we've had a lot of different taxes been introduced, different types over the last 100 years and more, but they've been shoehorned into these one type direct, another type indirect, in terms of the way the GATT has been written. And so there's the very big question whether this cash flow tax is a direct or an indirect tax. And if one delves down into the footnotes of the Agreement on Subsidies and Countervailing Measures, there's a under the indirect tax category, there's a catch-all phrase which I think would probably pick up the cash flow tax, kind of any other tax, not named. The cash flow tax has not existed previously, but another big debate. Now, on imported services, there's a requirement of national treatment, but very, very importantly, the language of the GATT on goods is not transcribed into the GATTs on services. It does not talk about products. So, you know, can you make the assumption that, well, they just were lazy, they didn't write the language, or they didn't mean it? And so on export of service, import of services, it could certainly be argued by the United States that imports of services should be taxed the same as domestic production, and domestic production has all these taxes on wages, Social Security, and Medicare taxes, and they should be counted as part of the national treatment equation. Another big debate. Finally, on export of services, there are no rules. There are no rules. If the U.S. wants to subsidize the export of services, it wants to give, you know, $10 billion to my friend Ralph Carter over here to export FedEx services, there is no rule against that. It's an unclear area. So if we take existing systems, the cash flow is most similar to the subtraction method VAT, which is used by the Japanese, but they don't call it a VAT. They call it a consumption tax. And the word VAT is probably known as not a popular word in many countries. And the Canadians chose goods and services tax, as did the Australians. The big vulnerability, which will be talked about in other sessions, is the disparate treatment of wages in the cash flow tax and the border adjustment. So very quickly, wrapping up on exchange rates and prices, there are a range of estimates. Because my time has run out, I won't go into them in any detail. But I would point out that the range is extreme. Doug and his colleague Auerbach and Feldstein have claimed that there will be a almost complete offset by exchange rates from any border tax adjustment. And corporations and Wall Street completely disagree. So you have this very large range. And any reduction in the trade deficit depends in part on some spare capacity in the U.S., and that's another debate. On the tax instance, the very brief remark I would make is that if the exchange rate offset is complete, basically foreigners pay the tax, and that's a very attractive feature for Congress. And if the tax has no impact on the value of the dollar, in other words, the exchange rate, there is no exchange rate adjustment, then ultimately U.S. consumers bear the tax. So that's quite a big range in terms of incidence. So thank you very much.
Thank you. So I'm coming at this as not a tax person. I'm a macro policy person. I do fiscal policy, but not tax code. Or put it in economics terms, I dropped out of public finance second year in grad school and took monetary economics instead. But I think sometimes it's good to have a different perspective. So in my tribe of monetary economists, there was a great mistake made by a few central bankers that, oh, well, there would be no problem with securitization on the effect on loan quality. It must be efficiency gaining, when there were, of course, people from a more microfinance perspective who were warning central bankers this might not work the way you thought it would, and of course it did not. I think there's a similar issue here. Public finance people, distinguished public finance people like Doug and Gary, but many others who've been cited in this debate, understandably, like central bankers with inflation, consider tax efficiency really important. That's what they study. And they consider that the effects of the tax code on macro outcomes must be important. That's what they care about. And Congress people love talking about tax because it's the one thing they really control. They can't pass laws and bills most of the time, but they can sure as hell get tax expenditures and special tax goodies and go to their constituents and say, I did this. And of course, there is a huge political aspect, in a good sense, of outrage over these images of American R&D being booked abroad, of other countries in Ireland, others going out and grabbing headquarters. It is unjust on the face of it. The whole thing is aesthetically very displeasing, whether you're a congressperson, a voter, or especially an academic who sees this very inefficient seeming tax system. But sometimes ugliness is only skin deep. And as a macro person, I care about things like growth rates, starting same place as Doug, productivity growth, the exchange rate over the long term, employment. Tax reform would help with these things, but not that much. And once you realize that it's a finite thing, it's not the be-all and end-all, despite the amount of excitement about it, because it happens to be the one thing Congress can get done, then you start saying the gains are finite. What are the costs? And there, like Gary says, well, the border tax adjustment or the CTUF is a cost worth paying. I take the opposite view, that from a macro perspective, from a broad tax perspective, the amount of revenue you're going to get is very low. The amount of distortions you're going to create is very high. The amount of trouble you're going to create for the U.S. and the world economy is very large. And the distributional effects are not trivial. They're actually very harmful. So if you want to have your huge corporate tax cuts, I don't particularly view that as a huge priority, but I accept that that's what the majority in Congress is going to pass. You should pay for them a different way. And you should not be using the destination-based cash flow tax or the border adjustment tax or anything like that to pay for it. Let me go through this. I'm very grateful to Columla Dreit, who did a lot of work to help me get together some charts on short notice. I'm very grateful to my colleague Bill Klein, who couldn't be with us today. He's off in New Zealand visiting family. But we published his new policy brief, like Gary's, differing views. And I basically 95% agree with Bill's, so I encourage you to read that policy brief. So let me get started. Are the gains from, is this working? Okay. This is the average effective tax rate as estimated by PricewaterhouseCoopers, or PwC, across countries. Japan, which has huge trade surpluses, has a much higher tax rate. Switzerland, which has huge trade surpluses, has a much lower tax rate. Germany, which has huge tax surpluses, has basically the same effective tax rate. It's fascinating. In macro, we have this thing called the Lucas critique, that you don't assume a policy has its effects just because it's stated to have its effects. The question is, what on net happens when corporations react? So I'm not going to get into all the niceties or non-niceties of transfer pricing, of booking things in different countries and all. The net tax rate is what we care about. And there are subtleties, and Gary mentioned the issue of pass-through. But the bottom line is the U.S. effective corporate tax rate on corporations is not that out of whack. So what about the impact on things we actually care about? Because the tax rate is just a means to an end. So what we've done here is taken four countries, or four groups of countries. The blue leftmost column is the U.S. The red is the average of a group of the other advanced economies, essentially the OECD minus Turkey, Mexico, Israel, Chile. Sorry, Jose. The green is the three countries, average of the three countries that have the lowest statutory tax rate, lowest effective tax rate, doesn't matter. Oh, no, lowest statutory tax rate, sorry. And the purple is a different set of three. But anyway, it's two different ways of looking at the lowest tax rate countries. It makes almost no difference to capital share and GDP. It seems to make a difference to TFP growth, but that's actually because we're using pre-crisis data. If you start looking at tax rates during the crisis, of course, there are all these losses that were incurred during the crisis that reduce the effective tax rate, so that's not fair. R&D expenditures as a percent of GDP, despite the supposedly horrible effects of this on R&D and investment, are still much higher in the U.S. than anybody else, and that's private R&D, not military. And then, of course, the U.S. is the only one that has a huge current account deficit on average. It's not just because of the tax code. So the sort of if you step back a minute, no matter how many natural experiments public finance economists run, it's very hard to see that the U.S. corporate sector is somehow holding back the U.S. economy, or the U.S. economy is desperately in need of change. So we actually do collect a relatively low share, but who cares? What the interesting question also, though, is efficiency of tax collection. So let's go back to this idea of if we change the tax code to repatriate everything. So we now have an estimate that $2.6 trillion of U.S. multinational company profits are held overseas. Last time we did a tax holiday repatriation was 2004. There were estimated to be $804 billion profits then, and about $362 billion were repatriated. So if we net this out, the total accumulation of profits abroad by our friends in the multinational sector over the last 12 years is flow of $1.4 trillion, which is real money. Some of that actually is for legitimate reason, but let's go to the extreme and assume that it's all just profit shifting. That's about $40 billion a year of lost tax revenue, which again is real money, but let's get serious. The total tax revenue for the U.S. government averages $2.6 trillion a year. So we're talking about 1/65th of the U.S. tax revenue is potentially at stake if you max out what you get from getting these profits to be booked at home. Worth doing? Yes. Worth sacrificing huge costs for? No. So let's start talking about the costs. So in theory, we just do this nice thing. We say U.S. has a big trade deficit. We have a 20% tax on the border at imports, $100 billion revenue. But that's wrong. First thing is, it's very uneven in what gets covered. There are huge things like tourism, like education, like hospital services, like internet services that would not be covered under this. So there's a huge share of revenue foregone. It's also very distortionary, of course, because what you're doing, therefore, is taxing only certain sectors and not others. Which, again, every tax does that to some degree, but biasing it very concentratedly on particular sectors is not good tax reform even for public finance economists, let alone for macro people. Moreover, if we're going to premise this whole thing, as Doug and Gary and many others essentially have, on cynicism about Congress, that there's only so much they could do and we need to do what's politically feasible, let's be realistic. Are they really going to have no exemptions to this tax in order to get it through? Or are they going to pick a certain couple industries, like, say, oil refining? I have nothing against oil refining. I have good friends who are oil refiners. My father grew up working for Shell, okay? But just as an example, right? Oil refining is massively hit by this tax. And they have congresspeople and senators who represent those districts. And imagine they go to Ryan and Brady and say, I want a carve out, or else I'm not going to support this. And Ryan and Brady say, oh, God, all right. Then the amount of revenue you're getting goes down, and then the amount of distortion you're getting goes up because the burden goes more on the remaining import-affected sectors. So let's not fantasize about this being neutral. Let's not fantasize about this being a money machine. It is neither. I asserted the other day, oh good, sell range. In my printed version, this is a set of basically 18, U.S. economy based into 18 industries. This is my fault, not Kalam's. The three red circles, what it does is it plots, don't worry, it'll make sense. The y-axis is the amount of imported value added in the final demand. These are industrial sectors. The x-axis is the average value added. Essentially, it's a plot of how much high-end manufacturing versus low-end manufacturing. The further you go to the right, the higher-end value-added manufacturing. The further you go up, the more imports, essentially supply chain complexity, affects them. The three circles, again, apologies, are in the going clockwise, are motor vehicles, computers and electronics, chemicals. Those are three of the most advanced, R&D-intensive, highest-paying, highest-value-added industries in the U.S. and the world, and they have three of the most, in fact, the most, import content in what they do. If you go to the lower left corner, you get things like wood products and metal extraction. So in other words, if you do a tax that's fundamentally biased against import content, you are taxing the most advanced, highest-value-added sectors in the U.S. manufacturing sphere. And even if these individual companies, because of the political lay of the land, or because they perceive things as some do, that this on balance is worth it to them to get the profit tax down, as a policy, this is wrong. This is taxing our most competitive, highest value-added sectors at the expense of our most backward sectors. The blue rectangle cell range is textiles and apparel. And I blew that out because, as we all know, textiles and apparel are at best a vestigial organ and at worst a parasite on the American body economic. It is the lowest value added of any industry except for wood products. It has huge import content. It's not relevant. Everybody else, the more value added you have, the more import content you have, the more complex supply chain you have, the more you draw talent and technology from around the world. And therefore, again, this tax would punish the most advanced sectors. Now, this is actually a preview of Chad Bound's presentation coming up. I'm going to skip the slide because I don't want to scoop him. What I really want to do is just talk to you about retaliation. Gary, of course, knows more, has forgotten more than I will ever know about the WTO. But again, having run the Peterson Institute for a few years, I do know a little bit about how this works. So let me tell you some sort of reality check. All right, I'll go back a slide, okay? The point is, as in Bill Klein's pull quote on the front page of Bill's policy brief, the Ryan-Beatty cash flow tax is protectionist because it imposes the tax on the entirety of import value, but only on the corporate profit component of domestic production. Full stop. I'm not disagreeing with Doug or others about the intent to be neutral, but the fact is the proposal that is on the table is not neutral. As Carolyn Freund will discuss after the panel, as Sherman Robinson will discuss in the second panel as well, this is not a VAT. This is different. And so when we talk about WTO, it may be, as Gary says, this is too big. It's not going to go to the WTO. And when we talk about WTO consistency, everybody can hire lawyers who says it is or it isn't consistent. The key point, going back to where I started this conference, not this talk, is the rest of the world exists. They are not going to roll over just because the US says, we're doing this and we think we have a case. There will be retaliation. And as precedent shows, the retaliation doesn't have to be in the form of a three-year-long WTO case, and it doesn't have to be in exactly the same field, but it is likely to be close to one-to-one. It is also ridiculous not to pretend there's no context to this. Even free traders like Congressman Brady, who we've had speak here at the Institute, God bless him, are going at this in a context where the Trump administration is actively threatening its trading partners. And so the idea that in the abstract, well, maybe this isn't such a big aggression, has to be seen in the context of what the reality is. Whatever the noble intent of the congressional people, the idea that this will not be escalating retaliation with large harms to the US is incorrect. Low-income Americans, Gary points out quite rightly, a key aspect of this is the exchange rate, but that's not the only aspect. Jason Furman, along with Catherine Russ and Jay Shambaugh, published a recent piece, one of the last things they did at CEA, looking at the impact of tariffs on low-income Americans versus high-income Americans. And as Bill Klein and many in this building have argued through the years, because low-income Americans consume such a large part of their income, and they buy the products that are at the low end, things like clothes, cheap electronics, but also cars, they suffer the most from tariffs. And Catherine Russ just recently posted online a summary of using that data to look at the impact of a border adjustment tax on income groups. There are various assumptions. You can go online and look at it. But essentially, this pattern is real. If you do a border adjustment tax, it is going to hit the weakest, poorest Americans very hard. So let's get to the exchange rate. Oh yeah, sorry, one other point. Again with the cell ref, all right. This is drawing on my colleague Jacob Kierkegaard's work. Obviously a VAT is adopted in many other countries and is regressive in every country it's adopted. In every other advanced economy, the amount of redistribution and the amount of protection for workers is far higher. So there's the United States. The bottom axis tells left to right how much of your VAT goes to general government revenues and GDP. The up to down, the vertical axis, again, thanks Coulomb, is how much you're changing the Gini coefficient. In other words, how much you're redistributing after tax. And the point is, the U.S. is nowhere on VAT and very low on redistribution. Canada, Switzerland, we're not quite Brazil. Good for us. But as you see, if you leave the U.S. out of it, essentially as you move up the VAT ranks, you have more redistribution. Because, of course, if you put a VAT on with no redistribution, no free health care, no free education, people suffer. And so, again, you can't divorce this from the context. You can't do an abstract, well, other countries have a VAT, so it must be okay. It's not okay. Other countries, it's okay because they protect their people. Finally, let's talk about the dollar. So as many of you who are aficionados of this know, the whole idea is that because this is neutral, the dollar then appreciates enough to offset all this, and that has all kinds of wonderful effects. Companies that are heavy on imports get to still buy the imports, households don't suffer as much, retaliation even is less from abroad because other countries say, well, what I lost on that hassle, I gained on the exchange rate. The problem is, and I've read this multiple times, and we discussed it a lot internally, this is a classic example of economists assuming the result. Okay, this is the assume a can opener story in live action. Very distinguished economists go out there and say, we know that the cash flow tax is neutral. If the cash flow tax is neutral, the savings minus investment balance must not change. If the savings minus investment balance must not change, and exports become more competitive, something must offset it. Ipso facto, the exchange rate must compensate. Problem is, this is completely unrealistic. This assumes the result. Of course savings are going to change, because the whole bloody point of this thing is to raise revenues to account for the ability to pass the rest of the tax package. And even if I say the revenues aren't large, I still say there's revenues, so savings goes up. If Doug and many other people are right, and the point of this is to improve corporate profitability, corporate allocation, corporate investment, investment must go up. I'm not talking about the direction of S minus I. I'm just telling you it sure as hell ain't fixed. Moreover, as we've mentioned, there's a huge disparity across sectors and a huge disparity across income classes. There is no way in the real world that this is neutral and has no effects on savings or investment behavior. Moreover, no household is going to see this. It's not a lie when retailers, and by the way, there's not a single retailer at the moment that supports the Institute, so this isn't paid for. It's not a lie that retailers are going to be able to go out there and say to their constituents, their customers, sorry, I'm putting up prices because of those guys who put up those taxes. That's not going to be a false perception. So the idea that savings minus investment will remain neutral is patently absurd, and therefore the effect on the exchange rate is completely indeterminate. And it is likely, Joe Gagnon will do his assessment later today, in my view, it is likely it appreciates a small amount and this is completely swamped by other factors. Why is it swamped by other factors? The dollar exchange rate is not determined by trade balances. Almost done. It's the global reserve currency. There's huge flows involved. People invest in the U.S. People invest in treasuries. People invest and intervene in the currency. People invoice in this currency. Just a reminder of the scale. The daily turnover in foreign exchange markets is $4.4 trillion a day in dollar trades. The amount of imports and exports in the U.S. in dollar terms is $408 billion per month. In other words, the currency flows driven by non-trade, non-tax factors are 300 times those driven by those factors. You really think this is going to have a predictable, large, sustained effect on the value of the dollar in such an environment? It's also kind of strange to me to think that this is essentially an argument that the dollar has been undervalued for decades because we don't have a VAT. I don't think even though Fred Bergston isn't with us today, I don't think many of us will stand up and say the dollar has on average been undervalued for years. It doesn't seem to me that the VAT is determining terribly much of what's going on here. Most importantly, if the dollar, and this picks up on Gary, if the dollar doesn't move, then all other costs grow. The income loss is bigger, the distortion across sectors is bigger, the likelihood of retaliation is bigger. There's a number of other ways, better ways you can raise revenue. I'm in my seventh term as an advisor to the CBO. They put out a great publication Doug used to oversee, annually, options for reducing the deficit. There are many things that would be much more efficient, much more constructive. And in a world where we're talking crazy politics, I'm not sure the people of the Congress should be thinking in terms of responding to white rural middle class anger by doing a corporate tax cut to raise consumer prices. What is politically feasible may actually be taxing high-end health insurance like mine, increasing the excise taxes on fuel, especially taxing carried interest as ordinary income. And since we're only talking about raising 50 bill to 100 billion here, we can get there through those means instead. So with all due respect to my friends in the public finance profession, the impact of tax efficiency on U.S. public macro outcomes is only of secondary importance. The actual revenues you're going to get by doing this DBCFT are very limited. They're real, but they're limited. The costs of getting revenues through this means are manifold. Congress has better alternatives to raise revenues to offset this. Please use those instead. Thank you.
Okay, so as hopefully was made clear just now by Adam, you can see one of the tremendous benefits at working at this institution is no necessarily alignment of ideas and open opportunities for vigorous, analytically based intellectual debate. So it's my job here now to moderate the panel, you know, and referee essentially a steel cage match between my boss and one of my intellectual heroes on trade, and someone else who's obviously incredibly articulate about these issues. So we look forward to this, and I look forward to the challenge. Now, I wanted to pose one question before I open it up to the audience for audience questions, and also give Doug and Gary and Adam maybe a chance to say anything else before we open it up. But the question I have, and maybe I'll ask this to Doug and Gary could chime in as well. So it seems like border adjustment, you know, as Gary put it, might be the price to pay, or a price he's willing to pay for territoriality and for lowering the rates. Okay, Doug, you mentioned alternatives, and we won't be talking a lot about those alternatives later today. So I wondered if you might just say a little bit more detail right now about what some of the alternatives practically might look like to deal with the base erosion issue that you identified, and you had mentioned out there Chairman Camp's earlier proposed option C. For those of us that aren't familiar with that, could you just kind of walk us through what an alternative like that would be and what the costs and benefits of that kind of proposal?
So the alternative that's been most prominent were a set of options that Chairman Camp put out to accompany his move to a territorial system. Rather than impose the discipline through the sort of the adjustment at the border, it basically puts you in the position of going transaction by transaction and identifying those that are genuinely business transactions between, say, a parent and its foreign subsidiary, and those which look like avoidance, a transfer, try a round trip, send it out there, bring it back. The reality is, you know, that everyone in this room is welcome to go online and read them. You'll hate me forever if you do. They're complicated, they're long, they're inevitably going to be constantly being amended as the world changes, and importantly, in this debate, I think there's big disagreements among the same kinds of sectoral alliances as there will be for adjusting a cash flow tax at the border. And So there's no panacea here. I mean, the reality is that tax reform is hard for a reason. It is intended to have a dramatic impact on the way the economy operates. And to my bemusement, many corporations look at me and say, we're all for tax reform. We got to have a better economy. We got to change the way things are going. I just don't want to do anything to my business. And that's just not possible. And so either through the base erosion rules or through the adjustment at the border, business models will have to adjust. And that's a reality of tax reform. I do want to address one thing Adam said about non-neutrality. This is not a neutral reform. It is taking, in the whole, it is taking the U.S. from a tax system that favors foreign production over domestic production to a tax system that is neutral with respect to location. That's not a neutral change. That's a change in favor of domestic production. And one of the things you see quite clearly is that those with heavy investments in foreign production for U.S. sale are the ones who are most concerned about this reform. And that's part and parcel of doing big tax reforms. It's why they're hard to get done. And the last thing I'll just say, and this is just editorializing, what Adam said about the saving investment balance is illustrative of the muddied argument that's going on out there. That's not about adjusting the tax at the border. That's about the whole reform. And yeah, it better affect saving. It better affect investment. That's the point. Our claims, Alan Auerbach and I, are simply about a conceptual experiment where you do all of the moves to the cash flow tax except adjust the tax at the border. See what happens. Lots of things will happen. Then do the border adjustment in isolation and watch the currency offset that. It's a one-time, other things equal appreciation, and there is no claim about the ultimate value of the dollar or the or how sustained any rise or fall will be. That's a very different argument.
It's hard to find alternatives, as Doug has said. One would be, that is, alternatives which are politically possible. So I don't think the gas tax, for example, is politically possible at this juncture, or denying mortgage interest. But possibly denying a net interest deduction just by itself within the current corporate tax frame, because interest income, of course, is very low nowadays. Interest income is actually taxed very, very little by the United States and by most countries. And a second big alternative would be simply to impose a minimum tax on all foreign earned income by corporate subsidiaries and get rid of the foreign tax credit. So a tax like 5%. Regardless of whether you're operating in Germany or Ireland or wherever, that would have the beauty of seeming to tax somebody outside the United States. It would, of course, divide the corporate community.
I just make three very brief comments. First, on Doug and the muddying. The argument I set up was not a straw man. The argument was the one published by Martin Feldstein, who is the Dean of American Public Finance Economists, in the Wall Street Journal a few weeks ago, and has been made by others. So Doug can say, quite rightly, he agrees, we agree, you know, that's not what's going on here, but that is the argument being made. And the muddying, to me, comes when people say, we're just doing this tax experiment. If we look at it in the abstract, yeah, then it's neutral. That's the muddying, because it's not in the abstract. Second thing is about alternatives. And I very much appreciate both Doug and Gary for their offering their views of alternatives. And that's essentially my point, that we have to think about what, there are costs, there are changes. We have to think about what is the best way to raise revenue if we take as given that you're going to have these huge budget-busting corporate tax cuts. And, you know, Gary may be right. You know, some of the things I listed are not so good. But I would urge us to hold Congress accountable. We've had massive political change and economic change in this country. As Doug rightly points out, this is something that's, no matter what form tax reform takes, it's going to affect a lot of businesses and a lot of people. Congress should not get away with just saying, we don't like that, we don't think it's feasible. You know, I really believe that increasing certain taxes on high earners, as well as Doug, as Gary's point about minimum tax on foreign income, could have political legs. Why don't we look? Finally, well, let me just stop there. Thank you.
Okay, so we're going to open up for questions. The rules are find a microphone, state your name and affiliation, and then ask a question with as minimal statement making as possible, so we have time to get through them all.
One operational thing Chad forgot. Sorry. If you're sitting in the Titanic lower bunk seats, there is a standing microphone there. Please come up and stand at the microphone. You will be recognized. If you're one of the soon-to-be-drowned Davos types at the front tables, Jessica will bring you a microphone. Thank you.
If you're in back, just come up to the
microphone. So, Grant Aldona, Split Rock International, former Undersecretary of Commerce for International Trade, former Chief Trade Counsel on the Finance Committee. Couple thoughts, but really questions. I'm struck every time I hear you guys, and Adam, you made the point that the public finance guys might benefit from some other perspectives economically, and I'm struck in this conversation that we have not explored things that are more common for us people who work in the trade area, like what's the impact on transaction costs. There's a great deal of simplification that is built into this proposal. I haven't seen any deeper analysis of what that implies about time and distance to market. It would be really helpful, I think. I don't know if you guys have thoughts about that. If you do, I'd like to hear them. I'd also like to know a little bit about what you think about it from an institutional economics perspective, because part of what we have is a deep mistrust in public institutions, and something that is very transparent and something that operates in a way that people see the mechanics of it in a way they don't with the corporate tax code begins to make you think about ways of rebuilding public institutions. And so I'd like to hear some comments about what you think about these various alternatives from an institutional perspective. And the reason I say that is I think we're missing some of the value and some of the thoughts that should be brought to the debate regardless of which choice. And Adam, I'd just say a couple things about your analysis, because I'm worried you might be assuming some of your own conclusions as well. Like on the...
I'm not.
Yeah. Ergo propter hoc. But the point being is that, you know, like if you look at Gini coefficients and you look at the distribution effects, you may not know that there's a difference between this, which David Bradford was trying to achieve with his X-Tax, relative to a credit invoice tax method. And what people don't usually realize is that the combination of high income taxes on wages in Europe and a credit invoice method taxation implies a double taxation of wages. And if you translate that into unemployment, you're saying, I'm going to give benefits to people with jobs, but the price is I'm going to have lower employment under that methodology. And to the extent that this method is moving in a different direction, that actually is powerfully helpful in terms of progressivity. And then, of course, on the raw politics of it, Adam, to be bluntly, you know what this boils down to lots of times? This is the debate I always face when I was at the Commerce Department is, do you want a job or do you want cheap underwear, right? And I think that's the political moment I don't want anyone to miss about what's driving this. So you think there's all these other options, and you think that maybe the people on the Hill who, frankly, operate in this market more than we do are missing the point. But I think that's the question that we have to answer with the sorts of things you were lining up. So I'd love to hear more thoughts about that, about how you approach people when the ultimate question is, do you want a job or do you want cheap underwear? Thanks.
I'll let Gary and Doug respond on the simplification and transparency. Let me respond on Grant's last 2 points. On the high income taxation, double taxation of wages, you know, the term double taxation is one gets thrown around a lot. What matters is the rate, the total rate, and the outcome, not whether it's double taxed. So if you look actually at labor force participation in Europe, it's been going up for the last 15 years. My colleague Jacob Kierkegaard has done a lot of work on this, and in some countries it's much higher now than in the US, and it's obviously in part because they reformed their tax code and got the total rate on labor down, and they changed some of the incentives. But the idea that somehow the US is doing so wonderfully on income taxation and that that's the main source of inequality. Also, Grant, check your definitions. The Gini, what you're talking about is an offset. The Gini is net of all that. And it doesn't have to be the Gini. You can look at any income distribution you want. The U.S. has one of the most unequal income distributions in the world. So, you know, there are a lot of things that go into that. It's not just the tax code. But don't obfuscate with these claims, because it's fundamentally misses the point. In terms of jobs versus cheap underwear, it's a question of whose jobs and whose underwear. If you end up deciding that you're going to make sure that the voters in Kentucky and Ohio, who in backwards, low-skilled industries, want lots of protection because they're the people who are your constituency and you want to get them jobs, you can do that. And you will effectively be taxing every American consumer, including every low-income American consumer, and you will be biasing the economy to go backwards, and you will have uncompetitive industries like we had in the 70s auto industry, where we were so busy protecting them that every American who had a car had a lousy car because there were no options. So, yeah, you can be all cynical and say, oh, this is the real world. But at some point, Congress is supposed to be called to account for what it does to the American people. And those are very, as Gary Hufbauer pointed out with the steel tariffs, and many others have worked on, including our friends at Cato, those are very, very, very expensive jobs. And so I don't think we should be allowing people to throw a tantrum and say, I want this job in this exact place, and the rest of you have to pay for it. That's not right.
In terms of the simplicity and transparency, I think that's among the virtues of this kind of a proposal. If you think about the three transactions that a large global company does, one is between foreign subsidiaries, the other is between the parent and foreign subsidiaries, and then there are domestic transactions between the parent and firms and households and nonprofits. In this system, two of those go away entirely. The only ones that are left are the domestic transactions. They're the most easy for the IRS to check on their authenticity. The cash flow basis makes it a very transparent system, very hard to disguise what your liability should be to either the taxing authority or to the general public. And so I think it, in terms of its institution building capacity, it's actually a step in the right direction.
Very briefly, I would say cost of complying with the tax code for multinational corporations does not bother me. It's very complicated. It employs a good number of people, but it's an extremely, extremely small fraction of the cost for multinational corporations. So that's not a transaction that bothers me. When we talk about transaction costs, the ones that bother me are for households. Thanks.
Thank you. Krishna Guha with Evercore ISI. Two very different questions, if I may, quickly. The first is, a lot of the destination-based cash flow corporate tax proposal seems to be seeking to replicate features of a VAT. Would everyone on the panel agree that a first best approach might simply be to introduce a VAT and perhaps use some of the revenues from this to reduce corporate income taxes, therefore reduce the incentive for transfer pricing abuses and so forth? And if that's right, is this completely politically impossible, or could we ultimately end up there through trial and error, having screwed up on some things along the way? The second question has to do with the international adjustments. And obviously, FX adjustment is a big piece of how this may play out. And there's been discussion about how much uncertainty there is about that. But we live in a world with a large number of FX pegs. Could the panel comment a little bit as to whether they would expect to see disruptive dislocations of some of those FX pegs, whether that's a Hong Kong peg, whether that's Middle Eastern petrodollar pegs, et cetera?
Let me quickly comment on the VAT question. If I understood the drift of it, I think you're right. I mean, this is a step towards the VAT. I happen to like the VAT, which is not a popular tax in the United States, which I quite recognize. I think that if we need more revenue for doing the kinds of things that Adam talked about, the VAT is the way to go. And so that's an aspect that I like. However, I realize that that's sort of a poisonous chalice as far as Congress is concerned today.
So I think that's right about the VAT. We've not seen one introduced. We've never taken a vote on one. And I think the political empirical evidence is pretty compelling. This is a step toward what David Bradford labeled the X tax, and the X tax is simply a progressive VAT in disguise. And so it carries more progressivity. I think it's valuable. It's politically feasible. Those are two virtues. In terms of currency pegs, you know, the as I said, the reform taken as a whole has an ambiguous impact on the exchange rate. I don't know what will happen. The topic du jour of the border adjustment feature unambiguously causes the dollar to appreciate. Most of the sort of pegs are typically asserted to undervalue currencies. So, you know, China's cheating by undervaluing historically, Vietnam, whatever it may be. It's hard to imagine they wouldn't repeg quickly, right? Why would they let their goods become less competitive in the U.S., U.S. goods more competitive in their countries? I don't think the management's going to interfere with the overall adjustment. Then there is the question of the speed and magnitude, and those are real issues. There's no doubt about it. My expectation is, you know, if something like this passes the Senate and heads toward the White House for signature, and everyone sees that the dollar will perhaps be higher, they will want to be in dollars. There are clear revaluations that are going to go on. So the speed at which this will happen is going to be very fast upon near enactment. And the magnitude, so obviously the debate, I expect a substantial magnitude. And one would think that those holding dollar-denominated liabilities and, you know, things like that ought to be worrying about that, monitoring this, and hedging. But, you know, the dollar's 20% higher now than it was a little under 2 years ago. These are swings that are not outside of historical norms. These are currency fluctuations that large multinationals handle now, and the world economy handles now. It has not melted down, and it won't melt down if we do a tax reform.
On the VAT, let me go two-thirds in agreement with my colleagues, one-third not. I completely agree that moving to a VAT would be a much better system. It's for a lot of reasons that they've articulated. And I would like to see a conditional on having some redistribution to compensate for that. But in any event, I'm perfectly comfortable with data moving to VAT. I do not believe this is a halfway house, and I believe there are a lot of costs to this specific halfway house. And so I'm not comfortable. I don't view it as, oh, partial is better than none. Partial in this case may be worse. Yeah. That's my view. They have a different view. On the exchange rate, I'm not going to flip-flop. I mean, I said it's indeterminate, and the effect of the tax is likely to be very small in the exchange rate, and I will continue to stand by that. However, Doug put it in a broader context and said, well, maybe we'll see all else equal rise there. So let's, again, as you well know, Krishna, exchange rate markets are always a muddle. So I don't want to see, and I'm not saying Doug would do this, but I don't want to see somebody seeing the exchange rate going up in coming months when this entire congressional tax package goes through and says, oh, well, therefore, clearly the bad argument is right. No, the exchange rate is almost certainly going to go up. The dollar will almost certainly appreciate if we have a large fiscal blowout and an increase in Fed interest rates. And if we have a shift towards capital, and if we have a political context that is enforcing trying to bring headquarters home to the U.S., all of those things will put very large upward pressure on the dollar. Now, what Doug says about people cope with it, I'm not going to get into that. That may be true. But let's not, you know, there's going to be a whole bunch of things that are going to be moving up the dollar in the next few months. There may well be a big appreciation, but let's not backwards induce that if that happened, it's because that particular argument about the border adjustment was correct. It's not going to be because of that.
Just for the record, the stated position of both Chairman Brady and Speaker Ryan just in the past few weeks is to achieve a revenue-neutral reform, not a fiscal blowout. And so until we actually see that, I think it's incorrect to assume that's what the proposal is.
Just for advertising purposes, the question on the VAT and the exchange rate, in our next session, we're going to have some empirical work being presented that's going to look at historical experiences to see what the exchange rate impact has been. So for the audience, for those watching at home, stick around after the coffee break. Okay, I think we're going to have our last question, and then we will go to break. And so I'm going to turn to Bill Gale from Brookings.
Thank you. This is a great conference, the right conference at the right time. So congratulations to Peterson. I want to ask about the exchange rate. I want to ask specifically about the border adjustment aspect. Doug, I understand the supply of currency for trade purposes and the demand for currency for trade purposes will adjust so that the price of currency, the value of the dollar for trade purposes would fully adjust. I get that part. Then I hear Adam saying, well, that's only 1/300th of the entire market for foreign exchange. So let me apologize in advance if I'm thinking confusedly about this, but I'm trying to figure out how an adjustment in 1/300th of the market plays out across the whole market. And if that's not the right way to think about it, let me know. But it seems like the demand and supply of currency for trading purposes is tiny relative to the overall demand and supply of currency. And I can't get how a tax and a subsidy in that tiny part of the market translates into the whole exchange rate market.
So the definition of a fool is someone who doesn't know much about international economics and comes to the Peterson Institute and opines on this. So here I go. Number one, I think this could be the classic case of thinking about margins instead of averages. What the statement is that the average piece of the foreign exchange market devoted to trade transactions is small, but this is about change at the margin and an important change. The second thing I'd say is I don't actually understand how you can separate those. You know, if you just go to the basic identity of saving investment balance here, current account over here, this is a trade. This is all financial flows. They're linked. They have to be tied together. And so what I fully would expect to happen if this were done in the textbook fashion, we do a tax form, we wait a year, do a border adjustment, the financial flows would appear to be driving the rate up because it would be the anticipation of a higher dollar that would cause capital to flow into the U.S. to be in the dollar when it appreciated, and it wouldn't look like trade did it at all. And I think that's probably what you'd see in the data.
Okay, anything else from the panelists before we? Okay, so we will take a 15-minute break, and we will reconvene. We're running a little bit behind schedule, but that's okay, at 10:40. Thank you.